Hi Sangeeta, lovely to see you and so good to have you on this conversation about big cats. You know, it's always been fascinating talking to you and it's amazing how much you know about Africa. Please tell us something about what started this fascination and how did this love affair with Africa and her big cats begin?
Thanks, Latika. Thank you so much both to you and to Chaitanya for inviting me here along with all these other people on the panel. What can I say? I first went to Africa when I was 22 years old. And I went to Algeria, actually. That's where I first went. That was my first ever real trip overseas from India at the time, if you don't count Nepal and Bangladesh and all that. And I remember when I landed in Africa, I was expecting Algeria. I had these visions of, you know, jungles and cats and all of this other stuff. And I land in North Africa, which is the Sahara. People don't look at all like what I thought they would. And very soon I realized that there's nothing about this continent that is at all anything like I thought it would be. And soon enough, I went on my first safari and just fell completely in love. I left Algeria about a year after. We spent some time in Morocco, Algeria, and then left Africa. But I found myself coming back year after year after year. And each time I came and I thought that I had learned something and I knew quite a lot, it was another whole big discovery. And now I find, you know, 30, 35 years later, that hasn't changed. I go back, I think I know something about Africa, and then it's a whole new thing all over again. The cats, of course, are a huge draw. They always have been. But I find myself now from, you know, focusing on the big cats to start off. Now I find myself equally excited about the littlest cat of Africa, which is the black-footed cat, and trying to go and see that. I don't know. It's just been a continuing love affair. And then at some point, a few years ago in 2012, I decided that I wanted to get away from, I used to be an interpreter and a translator, and I decided that I wanted to get into Africa full time. That's what I wanted to do. And so along with my sister Smita and her daughter Tanvi, we decided to start Chalo Africa. And we wanted to bring something a little bit different to the table, not just your regular safaris, which of course we do and we love. But I also wanted to bring two people, you know, people like you who really want to go off the beaten path and discover things that are different. I wanted to create a company that would allow me to discover along with people like you.
That's amazing. Yes. And I mean, those trips have been so, so, so special. And I put you through so many different situations trying to get places I wanted to get to. So yes, so I can already see myself forming new plans as I watch your presentation, reading the title Big Cats in some of the more remote parts of Africa. So fantastic, please.
So basically when most of us go to Africa for first timers, I'm not talking about people like you, but most people who first go to Africa, they usually go to Kenya, Tanzania, South Africa, Botswana, Zambia, Zimbabwe. And, you know, cats are always a big draw. And you have a pretty good population of lion, leopard, cheetah in many places. As you begin to travel a little bit more around Africa and sort of press beyond these more better known places, you find that the cats are different. Even if they're a lion, the different subspecies of lions, even if they're cheetah, the different subspecies of cheetah. And things are not quite as easy in these remoter parts of Africa as they are. They're not so well set up. The tourism infrastructure is not there. You know, when you went to the Bali Mountains and driving in the Harenna forest there, chances of seeing big cats in these places, they require a lot of patience, luck, and determination. I mean, honestly, you have to want to go and be able to see these things. So I thought the easiest way for us, in fact, to discuss these remoter cats in different parts of Africa would be to see that all pretty much, so lions, for instance, lions are divided into two main subspecies. The ones in sub-Saharan Africa that everybody sees when you first go on safari, and then the other subspecies, which is the Panthera leo leo, which you would see in North Africa, West Africa, and the Horn of Africa, perhaps. And it is, in fact, the Indian lion, the Asiatic lion, is part of this subspecies. I know you already have people talking about the Gir lions. So I will just stay with the African subspecies of the leo leo. And these lions are different from what you see in Kenya, Tanzania, and south from there. So let me start first with the Barbary lion. So here you see, here's a picture of the Barbary lion. Barbary lions were the biggest lions of all. They were supposed to be up to 300 kgs in weight, and their manes would extend all the way to the bottom of the body. These lions, unfortunately, these lions lived in North Africa, Morocco, Atlas Mountains. And these lions, the last of these lions was shot in 1942 in the wild. And people pretty much thought that these lions were extinct. Strangely, after that, you know, within a few years of these lions having been thought to have gone extinct, they discovered a couple of lions at a zoo that they tested and found were Barbary lions. And then they found some odd lions here and there in traveling circuses that turned out to be Barbary lions. And then the big mother lode was they discovered the zoo of the King of Morocco, who had been presented these lions from tribesmen in the Atlas Mountains. And he had started a zoo, and there is a collection of lions in Rabat in Morocco. And these form the nucleus of actually, they have like 35, 40 Barbary lions still existing. So now there is some sort of, there's a pretty good collaboration going on worldwide with zoos all over the world, whoever has Barbary lions and these Moroccan lions. And they're trying to see if they can somehow create a genetically viable population of these Barbary lions. People are talking about rewilding, but that's a little bit difficult because of the human population pressures and, you know, depletion of what these lions eat. But still, it would be really exciting if they could actually bring these lions back from the brink. Then it turned out, some years later, they found another collection. And you know about these lions, Latika. I know you'd asked me about them. These lions at Addis Ababa that they have here, these are from the collection of the emperor of the deceased emperor of Ethiopia, Haile Selassie. And he was presented lions also in the 1940s. And these lions here are descendants of an original 7 female, 2 male lions, or something he'd gotten. They did some testing on these lions. Now, these are the Ethiopian or Abyssinian lions. They're not quite the lions of sub-Saharan Africa. They're not quite Barbaries. They're not quite Central African lions. We really don't know. They haven't done a lot of research. They don't quite know where these lions come from. Some people believe that these Abyssinian lions still exist in the southwest part of Ethiopia. And perhaps, I like to think sometimes that perhaps these are the lions we find in the Herrera forest. I don't know. And here's another video clip. If you could play that, then what is fascinating about this lion population, they are somewhere in the southwest of Ethiopia. And there's these high mountain ranges there where you find the very rare Ethiopian wolf. And south, right south of there, is a very large forested area where the Ethiopians grow wild coffee. And to grow coffee, they need the forest. And it's because of this that these forests have survived, I think, all these centuries. And in these really thick, dense forests lives this population of lions, which are very rare to see, but you can see them in the rainy season when this torrential downpours. These guys come out of the forest and come on the roads, and so you're able to see them sometimes. So if you can play that video, that National Geographic video here, that shows one of these black maned lions walking on the road that you drove on when you were there.
So yeah. We couldn't see them at all. I mean, we tried and tried. And
we have to go back when it's rainy, and we have to go camp out there for 4 or 5 days.
Okay. Another thing to do in Ethiopia.
Just when you thought you were done with it.
No. There's still lots of bits I need to do.
Yeah. So this one, these are very interesting. So they're somewhat different lions. These are not the usual lions you will see. And to see these lions, you have to be patient. You have to time it right. So they're the rarer, among the rarer lions of Africa. Here's one of them. It's a gorgeous guy. In the forest, south of the Bali Mountains in Ethiopia. They recently found on the border of Sudan, North Sudan and Ethiopia, there's a small little park called Al Atash National Park and Dinda National Park on the Sudan side of it. And they have found a lion population here. In fact, it's your wild crew team that did the research here. There are almost no tracks at all on the Ethiopia side of the border. But on the Sudan side, you are able to visit that path. So that's another one, Latika. This one, yeah, don't know what kind of lions these are. So I really don't know. They've only done call-ups and, you know, they've seen lions here, but I don't think a lot is known about how many. What kind of lions? We don't exactly. And so now after the Barbary lion and the Ethiopian or Abyssinian lion, here now is a proper subspecies, which is the Central African lion. And as you can see, it looks a little bit different, smaller mane, smaller body as well. And these guys live in the Central African Republic. They live in Chad, Cameroon a little bit, some in a very remote park called Garamba National Park in the DRC. But there is, and the likelihood of a stronghold population existing is possible only in South Sudan. So possibly there are a good population of these lions in South Sudan. The situation there is such that nobody knows right now. There's not been enough research. However, you can see these lions very easily in Zakuma National Park in Chad. Zakuma is... Sorry?
More reason to go there.
Yes. Zakuma, as you know, Zakuma is about... It's been sort of on the horizon for safari people for the last 4 or 5 years. And it's absolutely an astonishing park. It's surrounded by nothing. When you fly into Zakuma, it's miles and miles and hundreds of miles of barren nothing. And then there is this astonishing, astonishing park in the middle of this nothing with the largest elephant herd of Africa. The single, you know, they sort of, so in Zakuma, the elephant herd moves in a single herd. So there are 400 or 500 elephants moving together. They have huge numbers of Central African buffalo, all kinds of birds that the skies are blanketed with birds over there. And then you have a population of the Central African lion. You're able to see them. You're able to see them there. Not so difficult to get here now. There are tourism possibilities here. We run a trip here ourselves every year. So this is one on the books for people who want to see lions in other parts of Africa. Like I said, South Sudan is the big mystery. And this is where we hope at some point when the war settles down and the situation is safe, that we actually do a proper census and find out exactly what is available here. I have a video here by the WCS, the Wildlife Conservation Society, doing a flyover over the swamplands of South Sudan. So I know a lot of us know Botswana and the Okavango Delta. Imagine this many, many, many times bigger than the Delta, with many times more the population density of herbivores, carnivores. Very difficult to get to, both for the political situation and for the fact that there is no infrastructure at all, no tracks. But we flew, Latika, not far from here, when we did our overflight. Do you remember that?
Oh God, how can you forget? and we saw the white-eared
cobs, yeah,
and the Nile lechues and all of that. I mean, it was just mind-blowing. And I mean, I was half hanging out of the window at one point.
No, I remember Latika hanging out of the window trying to take photographs, and my God, and the plane was going fast. But we were on the border of South Sudan.
Yes.
Right along the border, we could see the bushfires on the other side. Yeah, but we couldn't go there. But this would be a real amazing trip if we could do this someday.
We'll plan it.
Yeah, yeah. And so as you can see here, this picture by the Wildlife Conservation Society was taken just a couple of weeks ago. And just look at those animals. These are tiang. They're kind of topi that are found in this part of Africa. And just look at them. Just look at the numbers. So they say that this is the second largest migration after the Serengeti happens in South Sudan. And you have these animals. You have the tiang, you have the white-eared cob. You have a gazelle called the Mongala gazelle. You have Nubian giraffe, roan birds. Astonishing numbers of animals, elephants, and they're assuming, because there are so many herbivores, that there is going to be a pretty good population of Central African lions here. And here is the West African lion. This is the last of the subspecies in the African continent. Much smaller again than the Central African lion, crappier mane again. These animals are really, really critically endangered. There are possibly, they think, maybe 400 of these lions left. Of these, perhaps only 250 mature individuals. Found in very, very fragmented habitat. And the only somewhat sustainable habitat they have is here in West Africa, which is the W National Park, Arli National Park, and Benjali. So Arli is in Burkina Faso. W National Park is in Niger. And Benjali is in Benin. And this is like a transfrontier area. And here is where they have this last remaining population of West African lions. So I'm going to tell anybody who is interested in lion conservation, who's interested in safaris, let's come here. I mean, these people desperately need tourism. These parks desperately need support. And I think if we get us to come here and actually bring a little bit of tourism revenue to these parks, we would be doing a lot. We would be helping these lions enormously.
Let's go.
Let's go. Let's go. Certainly, Benjali is not so difficult to see lion there. You can see lions in Benjali. You can also see them, but this is an adventure. This safari will be not a comfortable one, but it would be enormously rewarding if we could start getting some people and getting them to come here and visit here. Because 250 individuals, I mean, that's they're on the brink of extinction. And so then so that's it for the lions. And then now we move on to the cheetah. Cheetah also, there are four subspecies. The ones that you see when you normally go on safari in the Serengeti, Kenya, Namibia, South Africa, you know, Zimbabwe, Zambia, all of these places, that's the first of these, the Jubatus. That's what you normally see. This Venaticus, is that how you say it, Latika? Venaticus. The Iranian, Indian lion, cheetah. Those guys are only found in a small pocket of Iran. And that one, I'd like to join you when you plan one of those trips. And so that leaves us with two types of cheetah in the remoter parts of East Africa, of Africa as a whole. So this was the historical range of the northern and western cheetah. And pretty much that is where we find them now. You see the red spots? The red blobs are where we can find them, but very small populations again, very, very small. For the North and West African cheetah, they are also found in Zakuma, Chad. So that's another reason to go there. And they are found in small, very small numbers in southern Algeria, in Niger, in Mali, and also in Penjari. That same place where we could see the West African. So these are interesting places to visit if you want to see some of these subspecies. Cheetah. I have a YouTube video here that was taken just last month by some Algerian naturalists, and they took pictures of the Saharan cheetah. Saharan cheetah have now been sort of pushed into the higher elevations of the Sahara Desert. Again, because of poaching, hunting by a lot of people coming from the Gulf states, and they hunt in the desert. So these animals have sort of run away to the higher elevations of the Sahara Desert. And very few subsist and very few are seen. Some people last month managed to capture pictures of this one Saharan cheetah. They estimate that they're roughly a little under 250 cheetah, but very, very hard to see. Occasionally, if you're lucky, you'll see them in Chad. In Chad and Penjari are the two places you probably will see them. This is a picture of that Saharan cheetah they saw last month. And this is a camera trap image. Isn't it adorable? So the North and West African cheetah belong to the same subspecies. And this is the map I had shown you earlier. And then you have, so this is again, the North or West African cheetah that you see in Zakuma, or you can see in Penjari. You are able to see them. And then the last type of cheetah, and this is again a very sad story. These guys are found in Ethiopia, in Somaliland, Eritrea. That was the Horn of Africa was their traditional. Most of them now, I mean, they do say that there is a remnant population, but not seen much. And you know, having seen how things are in Ethiopia, that it's unlikely. It's unlikely that a lot that exists.
We'd see people wearing skin. Lots of people wearing skins.
Cheetah skins, Latika?
It's also in my book. So I actually asked them about this, and they said that in the Mago and Omo areas, there are still cheetahs, and they actually do hunt them, and they were wearing them, Sangeeta.
Oh.
I'll send you the pictures.
Oh my God, yeah, please. Yeah. So yeah, you say that there are some in Omo and Mago.
And not old skin either. I mean, it was new skin. So I know that, you know, it's very much there in that part of the world. So of course, Mago National Park has almost been completely wiped out. But maybe in Omo, it's still there. And there is hope that somebody will find something. I don't know whether how viable the population is, because like you said, we have no information, but yeah.
But your Cheetah Conservation Fund is working in this area. Basically, this area of the Horn of Africa, Somaliland, it has become a hub for cheetah smuggling. So even down, they bring the cubs down from Kenya, Tanzania, and they sort of trafficked across the Gulf of Aden to rich buyers in the Gulf. And a lot of cheetah cubs die in the process. Those that are confiscated with assistance from the Cheetah Conservation Fund, now they have built a cheetah safe house in Somaliland. And the ones that they can intercept, they're trying to save them. Yeah. But it's just very sad to think that this was such a rich area for this eastern species of cheetah, and they're almost gone. Yeah, this is, and they just bring them up all the way, and you know, just given the situation in Somalia, given the situation in Eritrea and Somaliland, it's just very easy to bring these animals up. And then ship them right across to Saudi Arabia, Yemen, somewhere. And then on from there. Here's a rescued cheetah cub. Yeah, poor things. And look at this. This is what they're doing in the Gulf.
I have nothing to say.
Yeah, I could just...
Yeah. I don't know. Sangeeta?
Oh my gosh, that's great.
Yeah.
More, right, Latika? Did you see this in all?
Yeah, here you go, the Dasa neck.
Try.
Yeah. So I had the phone right here, and that.
I can see it, exactly. Oh. So that means there are some cheetahs still then in Omo National Park, yeah. And then we come last to this king cheetah. A lot of people think that this is a subspecies. Actually, it's not. It's a mutation. And it's found in the low veld of South Africa, Zimbabwe. If you're really very, very lucky, there's a park called Gonerizo National Park on the South Africa, Zimbabwe, Mozambique, in that little corner. And they have a small population of king cheetah there. Apparently it's a mutation that happens there oftener than elsewhere. You can see a king cheetah in captivity though, and in Hoedspruit. So next time anybody's headed to Kruger, if you really want to see a king cheetah, you can go see them there. And then from cheetah, we will go on to the Panthera pardus. As you all, everybody knows, there are leopard everywhere, everywhere in Africa, pretty much. Well, not everywhere. There are really no leopards in North Africa. So there are leopards in most of Sub-Saharan Africa, and then there are leopards in West Africa. Not known leopard populations in the areas where you have the West African lion or the North African cheetah. There are no leopards in those areas. This is a West African leopard that we have here. So you can see the distribution of leopards. So, you know, I'm sure you've got people, right, Latika, who are talking about the ones in Sub-Saharan Africa as a whole?
Yeah.
So really there's, the one thing I would like to say is most countries in Africa overinflate their leopard numbers. Really, it's very hard to tell how many leopards there are. And countries like Zimbabwe, Zambia, South Africa, when they calculate their hunting quotas, they have these big numbers, and I don't know where they produce those numbers from. And based on that, they have these, hate this word, offtake or harvesting or whatever they use, but from some of the research that has been done in West Africa and in parts of Zambia, it's true, it's absolutely true that people where they say there are 30,000 leopards, there are probably 3,000 leopards, if you actually do a proper scientific survey. So it's, you know, when you see a lot of these maps, it's hard to believe, like this particular map, it's completely wrong. And if you look and see the leopard numbers here, it's just not true. Although they do survive, and although they are clever animals, stealth animals, very adaptable, you know, they are also succumbing to the same pressures of habitat loss, fragmentation, poaching, hunting, all of that. I did want to mention, even though you have people probably talking about leopards in the rest of Africa. There's a very interesting project called the Cape Leopard Trust. And these guys have focused on leopards in the Cape area, in the Western Cape of South Africa. There's an area called the Cedarburg Mountains. I'm sure you know, Jatika, not far from Cape Town. These guys have been doing really, really good work in seeing how leopards cohabit with humans in this landscape here. And these guys have a vacancy. They're looking for a conservation director right now. It's called the Cape Leopard Trust. Very difficult to do studies in very dense rainforests, but people have done it. A couple of studies have been done. Fewer leopards than we imagined. There would be in the same thing that you saw in the tribes of the Omo Valley, Latika. Here too, in West Africa, you'll see a lot of tribal people, tribal chiefs wearing leopard skin. So there's local pressure, and plus there's international trophy hunting pressure on them. In fact, I just remember in Sudan, up in Sudan, in the Dinda National Park that we talked about, where there are lions, there are no leopards there at all. And the reason there are no leopards there is because they're poached, or apparently leopard skin shoes are very popular in Sudan. Huh. No worries. So I was just saying that in Sudan, in that same park where they have lions, Dinda, there are no leopards because they poach them to make shoes with leopard skin. Apparently that's the height of status in Sudan. So really, I don't know, I think education, tourism to bring people in and show them that there is a value to preserving these animals. I mean, really, it's just hard to know. At this point, sometimes it's so depressing, but it's nice to share this with the world, to know that there are places out there, there are parks out there that they did, I'm sure you've seen this, I'm not sure how many other people have, but they put this mirror out in the rainforest in Gabon. Not in the rainforest, in the, well, it is a rainforest, yeah, in Gabon. And they had a bunch of animals, including gorillas, walk by. And so there's a very nice, if you could play this video too, it's a really nice one of this leopard who comes and sees himself. And then he's kind of, so for like 2 days here, you know, looking at himself and being astonished by himself. But when you see these kinds of videos, I mean, you realize that these animals, these are not thoughtless, senseless beings. I mean, you know, these are living things, and you know, they deserve the same respect, the same value that you could ask them.
Did you read the new law that's been passed in New Zealand? So fantastic, recognizing all life as sentient beings.
And I just, you know, I think maybe the more, I guess what we can do is talk about this stuff. We can tell people, please come see these things. For one thing, we don't even know how much longer these things are going to last at the rate we're going. But hopefully when people see what these things are, they will realize that this is certainly not a thoughtless, this, a leopard is not a thoughtless animal. So that's that for me.
Wonderful. So I mean, this is all such magical stuff. Another 5 trips immediately that I want to go for. So Sangeeta, tell us a little bit more about the other places that you've been to, and you know, I mean, in Africa, the countries that you've been to that people don't go to very often. What is it like in terms of conservation? For instance, you just did a trip to Gabon.
I did.
And it's not a destination that most people normally go to. So what is it like? Is there conservation for, I mean, in our case, we're talking about big cats. Are there programs to protect the big cats? Do they follow any rules? What is the status of, you know, big cat conservation in Gabon?
So I would say almost zero. It's really very, very sad. Although the president of Gabon, the previous president of Gabon, his name is Omar Bongo, he was one of those people who designated a huge part of the country aside for conservation. So there's a large parts of Gabon that have been set aside, and they're either national parks or game reserves. But and there's a will. It's not that there's not a will. Local people do understand that, you know, there are laws out there. But in West Africa, there's a tradition of bushmeat. So there's a lot of bushmeat poaching because people eat primates. So chimpanzees, gorillas, all kinds of monkeys, pangolin. I mean, all kinds of animals are eaten. It used to be, until not that long ago, that it was hard to get to access the deep forest. But as always, the Chinese are there now. They're there to extract timber, really. These massive old growth forests in Gabon, you know, just incredible, some of the forests they have. But now they're building roads through them. The Chinese companies there that are doing that. And that does both things. One is, we know, the Chinese appetite for wildlife. And it is also allowing access to local people to go further and further into the forests. The animals are under pressure. For now, though, I have to say, it's still pretty much a virgin forest. There are areas where they have started cutting. But when you go to a place like Gabon and you sort of, you know, you're on a boat going down the Ugoi River, or you're doing something like that, it really does feel very, very, very special.
Okay. What about countries like DRC and all of this horrific news that we had from Virunga and, of course, now the big silverback getting killed in Rwanda?
Yeah.
It's just been, one thing after the other. But conservation status there, what is happening in that?
So I think, so it's interesting. So for the mountain gorillas, I mean, this was a one-off for this silverback being killed. I mean, really, Uganda, Rwanda, and even the DRC, they really do a good job on that side, protecting the mountain gorillas. I believe for this silverback, I saw him, you know, in 2017, I'd seen this guy, Rafiki. So it was apparently they were bushmeat poachers, and, you know, and he attacked them, and so they killed him. But for the most part, they do okay. For the most part, the numbers are growing for the mountain gorillas. Over in Gabon, Cameroon, DRC, you have lowland gorillas. And those guys are also doing not badly. There is some poaching, but not unsustainable at unsustainable levels yet, simply because access to these spaces is not that easy.
But are there big cats in
Are there big cats in?
In these countries, and what is the conservation status?
So in DRC, it's pretty much unknown, Latika. It's hard to get really to the center of the country. So much of it, you know, in Garamba National Park, for instance, I believe there are lion and leopard there. We have people who saw leopard in Gabon. And again, in Gabon, just like you saw, you know, the cheetah skin, I saw leopard skin in ceremonies in Gabon that people are wearing and using. There are leopard, no cheetah, no lion. A few years ago, in a very remote part of Gabon, they had the camera trapped one lion, and they thought lions were extinct in Gabon, but they have found one image of this one lion in this area called the Bateke Plateau in Gabon. But no, we don't think that there are lions. There may be one off, some migrant thing, but leopards, yes, no cheetah. So in terms of big cats, not a lot. What they do have in these places are other really quite extraordinary primates, from gorillas, chimpanzees, to all the monkey species you can imagine. They also have pangolins, giant pangolins, tree pangolins, and they have these animals called the Red River Hogs. They have some very, very unusual and beautiful, and of course, forest elephants. Forest elephants are what you find in this in West Africa. So I would say in West Africa, in terms of big cat conservation, wonderful work being done in Chad, wonderful work being done in Benin at Benjari National Park. I think people are waking up to the fact that, you know, these numbers are declining. But I think really what we need to do, us on the tourism part of it, is do things like this, do talks like this and try and convince people. You know, even if we can take 15, 20 people a year, that brings up, you know, that makes people think they have something important to preserve.
Yeah. Okay, so another question, because I think this is really more and more important now. When you're planning a trip, Sangeeta, how do you find a balance between being responsible, being sustainable, finding a safe place to stay? Because I think safety is an issue in a lot of these areas. And also, you know, ensuring that the trip always contributes back to conservation, back to the local community. How does that work? How do you do it?
I think here is where you need to really, at the front end of it, Latika, do a lot of research. I mean, essentially, even when we plan trips, say, to Kenya or Tanzania, important to just, you know, before you send people there, to look into these companies and see, are they just simply their extractive tourism operations, you know, all they're doing, or are they putting back into the community? I think you'll find that more and more of the companies, the safari outfitters all over Africa, are really investing in community. And which is really the only way to do this going forward. I mean, unless the local people think that this is a net plus for them, this wildlife, it's hard. But I think, so in order to plan, it also depends on people's adventure tolerance, Latika. So there are some people, and we can actually do this, they can go to very nice. So for instance, you can go to the And Beyond Lodges in Botswana and have a very good conservation safari, although they're quite luxurious and they're all, you know, quite upmarket. Because even though these are expensive, comfortable camps, that doesn't mean that they're not doing a lot of good in the surrounding community.
We've actually got Les talking on this about the work he's doing on conservation. So I'm really looking forward to that because they do some really amazing stuff.
They really do. And so there are a bunch of companies, good, solid companies out there, mm-hmm. even in the more traditional safari countries where we can do something like this. Mm-hmm. For the non-traditional safari countries, what I look for most of all is safety. And safety and then the experience, whatever it is that people are going there to see. So it might mean roughing it out. I mean, in Evindo National Park in Gabon, for instance, we were sleeping in the middle of the jungle on a platform and, you know, forest elephants screeching underneath and absolutely no nothing. You know, you'd have no infrastructure at all. But that's what people are going there to do. That's what they're going there to do. As long as it's safe, that's what I keep in mind. Comfort, you're going to have to abandon.
Yeah.
To some extent.
Really perfect for post-COVID lockdown holidays because you can travel in small groups, have your own vehicle, plan your own trip, be socially distanced from everybody except your little group, and, you know, spread the goodness, go into areas that really need your attention and to feel like the world acknowledges that they still exist, that the world hasn't forgotten them.
That's so well said, Latika. So I was, this March, a couple of months ago, I was in Chad and I was in this place called the Enedi Massif. It's in northeastern Chad. Mm-hmm. And it's an area, I think it's 40,000 square kilometers. That's huge, it's a huge area. And we were like six people in this area. Six guests, some of the, you know, camp crew and things. We were mobile camping all over. And the local you know, Tubu people who live there. And that's it. And so, you know, in these, as you said, in these post-COVID times, to go to some of these places where it's just wide open spaces. It's you, it's nature, it's the animals, it's the landscape. It's the local people who live far removed from.
So this is, I mean, this is really the sort of tourism that I think a lot of people, especially the new generation, is looking to do. The only fear is that that going into these remote areas at a time when there's COVID, you hope you're not spreading COVID. So you need to really make sure that you've got your certifications that you're COVID free at this time, because we don't want to be, you know, re-spreading the disease to bits where there are no medical facilities or...
That's exactly right. And actually, it's quite interesting to see now in this time, a lot of these countries, as well as safari outfitters, they've all developed pretty strong COVID protocols. So what we've started to do now is, if people even inquire with us, can we go here? For like the last 2 months, we almost had zero inquiries, but now inquiries are coming back and people are asking. And what we're doing now is we're saying, all right, we think you should go here or here or here. And the COVID protocols of those camps. So they can see exactly, you know, how the camps, they're saying no more than four to a vehicle now. If you're in a group, they don't try and mix groups, they try and keep you separate. Separate dining, no more communal dining. And you know, also you're doing the kind of holiday where you're far away from them. It's not like going to Rome or Paris or something.
Yeah.
Right?
So not at all. I think this is a really good message, you know, to say to people that think of destinations that are not mass tourism destinations. Think off the beaten track, be adventurous, go for longer stays instead of doing several short stays, go for longer stays, really get to enjoy the new place, you know, meet people, make friends, immerse yourself in the wildlife experience. I think
Are you noticing this trend in India as well, Latika?
Yes, absolutely.
Are people coming in now?
Yeah. Because I think local tourism tourism is more or less looking at slow tourism. So you're not jet setting all over the place, but driving with the family to somewhere and slowing down and, you know, really giving time. But we're finding that a lot of focus is shifting from conservation and, you know, climate change and environment to just simply combating the aftermath of the COVID lockdown. Because so many people were affected by it that obviously the attention has shifted there. You know, it's like an SOS thing. Yes. And I think it's going to take a little bit of time for people to come back to looking at, you know, the bigger looming threat. You're forgetting that there's a big forest out there. You're just sitting and looking at one tree and forgetting that the rest of the forest is still there. And I think that's the big climate change problem that we have to go back.
And I think even this COVID thing, I mean, if in fact it is a zoonotic virus, if it in fact has jumped from, you know, wildlife to humans, then why is that so? And what are we doing? I mean, you know, all these Ebola outbreaks that happen and still people, you know, you think by now people would know that this is not a good idea. You know, you can have terrible diseases. So I don't know. I think people just need to understand that this, you have to live holistically, sustainably, to live in this. This is the only planet we have.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's like Dr. Andheria said a few days ago on the thing. It's not about economy only. And it's not economy at the cost of the environment. It's economy and ecology, two prongs of the same thing. It's like two parallel tracks of the railway line.
And yeah, well said.
You know, you can't drive a train on it otherwise.
Yeah, exactly right. And I think this is what we need to convince people, that it's not a zero-sum game. I mean, by protecting wildlife, for instance, or by protecting these keystone species, you know, these big cats. Yeah. I mean, there's so much that
comes
domino effect from there, right?
Wonderful. So thank you, Sangeeta. This was awesome.
People started reading and buying ACT, and they started publishing in large numbers when there was a black buck incident in Rajasthan.